you have a copy of your Bible with you, please turn with me to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. We'll be looking particularly at verses 14 through 21, but we're going to reach back and grab verse 13 as well, just to have a little context of what we're looking at this morning. And what a fitting intro to our message, to hear testimonies from September and Daniel about what God has done in their life. Didn't they do a fantastic job? That's just that's one of the most exciting things that I just look forward to as a church, so we get to celebrate together what God's doing in people's lives. And that's just a fitting intro this morning to Acts chapter 2, of Pentecost. And if you'll remember from that message several weeks ago when we intro the first few verses of the chapter, God's Spirit has fallen on the believers. They were together praying, and God's Spirit has fallen on the believers, and tongues of fire came to rest on each one of them. And they began to speak in other languages, boldly declaring the mighty works of God. And it just so happened that when this event happened, it corresponded with a large gathering of people in Jerusalem from nations all over the globe, so that people are able to hear what God has done in their own language. And as you can imagine, this drew a crowd. I mean, that would be the response that we would have. And these people are described in verse 12. The crowd is described as amazed and perplexed, and which I think is a fitting description. And it's kind of in the middle of this crowd that we get to step into this morning. Our passage kind of picks up. So as we read these verses together, we're kind of in the middle of that crowd as well, responding to this is what God has done at Pentecost. Beginning at verse 13, it says, "But others, mocking, said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel. And in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoke and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.'" Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we rejoice in your grace and your kindness that's already been demonstrated this morning in so many abundant ways. We rejoice in your goodness and song. Lord, this morning we come to your word, eager to hear from you, eager for your Spirit to open up your word to us, your people, eager for you to have your way in our midst, eager for you to reveal your glory and your goodness to us. And Lord, apply it to us right where we are. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as many of you know, and probably the rest of you can tell by now, I am from the South. And I know the accent kind of gives it away. And I'm originally from South Alabama, which, if you're familiar with that region of the world, kind of the Gulf Shores and Orange Beach area, it's kind of the vacation destination over there, kind of like Port Aransas is here in Texas. And it's great living there. It has a lot of advantages. Obviously, you get to go to the beach whenever you want to. But one major disadvantage is that every August, September, you have to start kind of watching out for the tropics and kind of keep an eye on what may be coming into the Gulf. And you end up having to do crazy things like stocking up on plywood and batteries and stuff that they call canned meat. And you have to just fight people over a month's supply of canned meat. And every few years, it actually paid off, and a hurricane would come on shore near where you were, and you were supplied and ready. And normally, it just pushed on through, and you went about your daily life after that. But there was one storm in particular. I remember it was in 97. It was called Hurricane Danny. This particular storm, as it made its way on shore, just kind of stalled. And it tried to get there, and it tried, but it couldn't quite make it. And it got stuck in Mobile Bay for 48 hours. It just sat. Just sat on shore, and it sat right off of shore and dumped rain. And it dumped an insane amount of rain. I've never seen so much water. I mean, all the rivers filled up, the ponds filled up. If there was a hole in the ground, it filled. Everything was filled to overflowing. And you don't really envy the weathermen. They kind of live for those moments, right? This is the town when everyone literally has nowhere else to go. They have to sit around and listen to what you have to say because you need to explain to them, and it's your job to kind of explain to them what's going on, try to help them interpret what they're seeing. And they kind of, after 48 hours, they run out of stuff, right? I mean, you're eventually thinking, what else, how else can I describe this? And so people are just kind of, they're kind of grasping it, summary statements. And I'll never forget one guy, finally, he just says, folks, this can only be classified as an unprecedented deluge. And I thought, you know what, that's a fitting description for what's going on. It's a fitting intro this morning because that, my friends, is exactly what we're seeing in Acts chapter 2. Peter's standing up and he's saying, an unprecedented deluge is underway in this world. God, just as God had promised before, this supernatural is being poured out into the lives of the church. And yet, as our passage opens, we read in verse 13, there's already this resistance that's beginning to be built towards God's work and God's people. And you see this, and so this, it looks like, in this case, an accusation against the disciples' character. These men must be drunk. That's what they lob out there and see if it sticks. These guys must be drunks. And this moment has come for the church to speak. This moment has that somebody just like the weatherman has to step forward, has to begin to explain this is what's going on, this is what God is doing. And so you can kind of feel this drama building. You can almost make an entire message out of Peter's just response in and of itself. But you feel this drama building. This is the first test of the church. Jesus has gone back to heaven 10 days ago. He left them with a message to take this gospel and preach it in his name and in his spirit throughout the world. And yet, here they come against this first test. And the question then becomes, is the work of God, the initial outpouring of God's spirit on his people, is that going to be attributed to alcohol? Is that what people are going to leave? Is the crowd going to go away thinking, okay, well, that's what happened. Those guys were drunk. Or is God's mighty work, is it just going to go silently into the night, or is it going to go to the nations as God had promised that it would? And so this time is here to speak. And it's fitting that we take a moment to look at how it's that Peter is the one who stands up and speaks. And if you're Theophilus, you know this Peter guy. The previous book was written to Theophilus by Luke in his Gospel of Luke. And he had described Peter before. Peter, we've seen 7 short weeks ago, had standing around a campfire on a cold night. He had denied Jesus altogether. He said, I don't even know the guy. He had had an opportunity to speak in his own strength on behalf of Christ, and he declined to do so. And so you have this idea, you should just feel how fitting it is that the person who stands up in this moment when the time comes is that it's Peter. Maybe you can relate to that a little bit. Maybe there's a time in your life where you're like, you know what, I specifically, even maybe recently, I can vividly remember there was an opportunity I had to step forward and I attempted to do it. I wanted to. But it just didn't go well, or I didn't step forward and I disobeyed. I didn't take that opportunity. Maybe you've never even attempted to step out and share and speak up on behalf of Jesus Christ. Maybe you've never attempted, you thought, maybe I should do that, but it's never happened in your life. Well, this morning, if you're prone to think that way, that God's mission may somehow have passed you by because of those moments in your past, let this man in this moment encourage you. It's important that we see that it's Peter. And if you belong to Jesus, there are moments left. There are moments left that God has planned for you in the power of his Holy Spirit to boldly speak about him, to boldly declare his worth to those who don't know him. There are still moments left in your life that God has planned for you specifically to boldly speak in his Holy Spirit to those about his worth to those who don't know him. In his own strength, the first time we saw Peter, he drew a sword and attacked. In his own strength, the second time he ran away. But the third time, because he's relying on the strength that God gives, relying on the strength that the Holy Spirit has been given, he stands. This is a glory to God moment. He stands and he speaks. And while he's speaking, you notice the second thing that's really important from this response. He's not standing alone. Peter's the one talking, but it says here in verse 14, he was standing with the 11. And if you remember from several weeks ago, there was this imagery that 12 apostles had. The full number of God's people is represented. Just like in the Old Testament, the 12 tribes of Israel, the full number of God's people are present. There's this symbolic full number of God's people together when the 12 tribes, the heads of the 12 tribes are together. In the same way, as we see these apostles standing together, 12 apostles, we see this symbolic new Israel, the church, the full number of God's people standing there together with Peter. They're standing with him. And so this should just encourage us. Anytime that we take a stand, anytime that we attempt to speak on behalf and say, declare that Jesus is Lord, you're not doing it alone. When Peter stood up, you're supposed to catch this phrase here. You're supposed to remember that right here, there's a comma, standing with the 11. That doesn't have to be there. But he wants you to see, standing with the 11, he's not standing alone. And so as you stand, what are those places in your life where you feel like, you know what, every time I attempt to go and step into that moment and speak on behalf of Christ, I just feel like I'm all alone. I feel like I'm doing it by myself. I don't know where those times, places are. For different people, it's different. Maybe for you, it's when you walk in the doors of your workplace and you feel like, man, I'm the only Christian in this place. Every attempt I have had to share my faith, I feel like I'm all by myself. Or maybe it's in your family. Man, nobody in my family is a Christian. I'm the only one in my family that's a Christian. Every time that I try to stand and say something, I just feel like I'm all by myself. Or maybe it's in your neighborhood where you don't know any other believers. Where do you feel alone? When you've been called and given an opportunity to speak up on behalf of Jesus Christ, on behalf of his mission, like Peter did, where do you feel alone? Let this phrase right here, he was standing with the 11. Let that encourage you. There are believers throughout history. When you declare that Jesus is Lord, you are making a universal, Holy Spirit-empowered declaration. There are people throughout church history. There are people in heaven even now. There are people in this earth that are standing with you. They're standing with you in those moments. Even if you feel like you're alone, let this phrase, standing with the 11, just encourage you this morning. And finally, despite this being a spur-of-the-moment kind of reaction from Peter, you notice that he gives us a great pattern for how we're to answer. So you see this accusation that we had seen in verse 13 is just kind of lobbed. And don't be surprised, church. Don't be surprised when many in the culture are going to label your efforts for good as evil. Don't be surprised about that, particularly as you stand for the gospel. Maybe you've experienced that yourself. Maybe you've experienced some sort of character attack against your own self, even when you're attempting to speak for good. You're attempting to try to share the gospel. Maybe you've experienced the kind of character attack that the disciples are under here. But notice this. Peter doesn't answer back. Look how he answers. He doesn't answer back in an angry, proud way, which that's a difficult thing to receive. It's a difficult thing to go through. And it'd be easy to kind of come back in our own pride and be like, you know, just kind of in anger and in frustration respond. That's not how he responds. The other thing that's important is you notice that Peter doesn't stop being Peter. If you've ever gone fishing with an old, like, sea captain, if you say something, you'll know, if you say something ridiculous, you're going to get pinned to the wall for it. Like, they're going to call you on it. Well, Peter doesn't stop being Peter. So when he answers, yes, it's in humility. Yes, he's not answering angrily, but he's just going to call a spade a spade. He's like, look, guys, seriously, it's 9:00 in the morning. These guys aren't drunk. I mean, he just lays it out and says, look, I'm just going to answer. And that's a satisfactory answer in that culture, right? Because in 1 Thessalonians 5, Paul had said, those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. That was just kind of an explanation. So when Peter hears this, he's like, look, come on, man. I'm just going to tell you straight. It's 9:00 in the morning. These guys aren't drunk like you're talking about. Just forget that nonsense. Humbly answering with facts and presenting just sound responses in those moments sometimes can be very, very helpful. It's a great pattern. It can be very helpful. But ultimately, as you'll see from Peter going on, this is not our main response. Our main response would be to use those things to cut a road straight to the Word of God, to cut a road straight back to where the true power is. Folks, our hope is not in human wisdom. Our hope is not in human understanding. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness. Listen, our greatest defense in the face of these type of accusations, our greatest defense is not a self-defense. Our greatest defense is a scriptural defense. our greatest defense, is not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces. When we as God's people, in the power of God's Spirit, speak God's word, God can use it in that moment to turn someone who may be a scoffer into a saint. That's where our hope is, in God's word and the power of his Spirit. And just like the weathermen did in that storm, Peter steps forward to summarize what's going on. He's declaring to the hearers, he said, listen to me, give ear, everyone that can hear me, listen to this, let me declare what's going on. The captive audience, you are standing right smack dab in the middle of the downpour that God has promised through the prophet Joel. God's unleashed Spirit is going to fill every corner of the globe with his glory, both in the church and in the heavens. In referencing this passage in Joel, when he goes back and references the prophecy coming from Joel, Peter is making a very, very strong Christological statement. First, you don't have to turn there, but when Joel opens his prophecy, he opens with this generic, and it shall come to pass. This is a generic time period that's coming into play there. When Peter opens it, he specifically says, in the last days. Look in verse 17. He says, and in the last days it shall be. He changes that introduction to make it very specific to reference the last days. That's important. That's an important thing to be aware of, because if you're here in Jerusalem at that time, you would have known that the last days that he references, they were supposed to be ushered in by the arrival of a long-awaited Messiah. So if any declaration that the beginning of these last days had started would carry with it a very strong assumption that the Messiah, in fact, had already come. Jesus is the Christ, is what Peter is saying here, which Peter will make even more explicit as he gets into the second half of the chapter. And that's absolutely essential, because the Messiah ultimately came to bring us to God. In the middle of this supernatural event, this miraculous event, it's easy to just kind of lose sight of that. The church just didn't receive an attribute of God. The church didn't just receive a blessing or a gift from God. They received God himself. It says, in the last days, I will pour out my Spirit. It's God himself. That's the point. In his book, God is the Gospel, John Piper responds to the idea that the gospel is not only or even primarily a way to keep people out of hell and going to heaven. And that's very, very important. But he makes this point. He says, the gospel is not a way to get people to heaven. It is a way to get people to God. It's a way of overcoming every obstacle to everlasting joy in God. Listen, the gifts are not even the point. God is the point. God in our midst is the point. As sinners, being able to be in God's presence is the point. That's the goal. That's the aim. And you're supposed to see this imagery. You're supposed to kind of feel this imagery as we move on in the text, and we see that I will pour out my Spirit. And there's this idea that there's this ginormous picture of God's presence, that he is ready, standing eagerly, waiting to do that. As soon as Jesus got back to heaven, he wants to pour himself out into the midst of his people and be dispersed. And you have this tiny little globe. I mean, it's just this little bowl, this little cup that can't take it all. And it's just like that hurricane, you know, where it dumps all this, and it just overwhelms everything and flows out. That's what Peter's saying here. That's what's going on. This is a prophecy that's being fulfilled. The third person of the Trinity is being given with literally no reservations whatsoever. No reservations whatsoever. We're to be filled to overflowing with the Holy Spirit. And I like what was said in session one of the proclaim material that we're going through in our small groups. I like this statement. It says, we serve a God who gives his Spirit gladly. We serve a God who gives his Spirit gladly. There is no reservation here. There's no reservation in his pouring out of the Spirit. That's what's meant by the promises that follow in these verses. They're meant to be both broad and they're meant to be very specific. Look at the wording. It's broad. It says, I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. There isn't a limiting factor in that statement. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, there is not a special denomination this belongs to only. There is not a special group of super Christians somewhere that only has access to this blessing. There's not a special place on earth where this you have to go to receive this blessing. There is not a special time in church history where this has only happened for a moment and now it's gone. Now, are there seasons of favor where this outpouring is manifested in some supernatural ways? Are there seasons where it looks more supernatural than others? Absolutely. Absolutely. This passage is one example. God may choose for it to look different for us, and that's okay. If he chooses to do so, that's okay. But listen to this. We serve a sovereign God. We serve a sovereign God who can manifest his supernatural work in our midst here, however, whenever, and in whoever he chooses. Joel's prophecy is broad, and our interpretation, our expectations from this should be broad as well. The calendar doesn't limit God. 2017 in North America doesn't limit God. It's included in the all flesh. This is supposed to be a broad promise, a broad prophecy that's being fulfilled. And just to make sure you get the point, he's cast a very wide net, but then he goes on to be very, very specific. You're going to fit in one of these categories. Listen, you aren't the wrong gender, you aren't the wrong age, you aren't the wrong socioeconomic status. You're not left out. There's not a limiting factor. Your sons and your daughters, both and. That's what I mean when I say all flesh, Peter says. The teen and the senior citizen, the young and the old. Maybe you think you're too young, or maybe you think that your time has passed. No, this includes you. That's what I mean when I say all flesh. Even those that the world has little regard for, God regards. Maybe you think, I don't have a high enough education level. Or maybe you think, I don't have a high enough status in this world to be able to speak on behalf of Christ, for him to use me, for him to embolden me, for him to strengthen me to speak. You're included in the all flesh. That is the point of why it's being very specific. And if you belong to Jesus Christ, get this, God didn't miss your life. He didn't miss your life. At Pentecost, notice, it wasn't just the 12 who received the Holy Spirit's outpouring. It was all the disciples. Each one received a tongue of fire that descended upon them. God's Spirit is poured out on all believers because no Christian has any more qualification than you do, and you as a Christian don't have any less qualification than anyone else, because our qualification is all the same. The finished work of Jesus Christ. We all stand there. None of us did anything to deserve it. This gift of God's presence in our life, we didn't do anything to deserve it. And yet it's graciously given to us. It's graciously poured out on us. Your qualification is the same as the qualification of the Christian at Pentecost. Your access is the same. God, if you are in Christ, God's Spirit has been poured out on you. In our culture, human reason and logic, they kind of serve as the governing authority in a lot of things, a lot of decisions that we make. And that's helpful in some ways. It's helpful to have that kind of stability in some ways. But that cannot be the governing authority for the church. Just like a governor is placed on an automobile that limits how fast that car can go. Judging things by only what we can see and not by what God has revealed and promised can limit God's Spirit in our midst and bring the life of the church back down to where we just try to be good neighbors and pay our taxes on time, which is coming up, by the way. We need to do those things. We need to do those things. But Scripture and the promises of God should be our governing factor. They should pull humanism right out of the equation. And our prayer actually can be here in this country. Our prayer can be, God, be set free in your church and be set free in my life, just as you promised to do. You have that access. It is a broad, and in case you think it's not referring to you, it is. If you belong to Jesus Christ, it is. You may be amazed at what God has in store for you that you would have never even thought of in your own wildest dreams. A plan that he has to use you. That's the point here. What we're going to look at in just a minute, this isn't meant to be a comprehensive list, but it's more so an ushering in of an age where God's presence is in God's people. Each one of us has been given God's enabling power to accomplish supernatural things, things that we could not do in our own strength. At Pentecost, it looked like prophecy in tongues. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy, God says. In its broadest form, this is any Spirit-empowered, out loud declaration of God's glory, especially the gospel. In any Spirit-empowered, out loud declaration. In the previous verses with the tongues, that looked like tongues. That's what it looked like, speaking in a different language supernaturally. It may look like that again. God can do that. But it may also may be an anointed prayer for somebody who's hurting. I remember I had an opportunity when I was in college to go overseas and serve in Thailand on a mission trip. And I was staying in a guest house, and I crossed paths with this guy. He was staying there as well, and he stopped, and we started chatting. I'd never met the guy before in my life. We had a five-minute, very pleasant conversation, just talking about different things. And when we got done, he said, "Can I pray for you?" I said, "Sure, okay." And I just thinking he's going to have this generic, kind prayer, and I thought, well, I appreciate that. And he just starts praying over me in a way that I was thinking, how does he know that? Like, and it wasn't just like one thing. He just starts praying, and he's like listing off something. And he's like, I was like, man, has this guy been sneaking in my room, stealing a journal, looking at what I'm writing down, you know? I mean, he was praying specific things over my life. God was using him in that moment to do what was beyond in his own knowledge. There's no way he could have known those things. But God had anointed that time. His spirit was, and that prayer just blessed me to no end. It may look like that. It may look like an impression that God gives to you on a Sunday morning to come and encourage the church, a word of prophecy. That's why we have this microphone up here on Sunday mornings. If God's prompting you to do that, I just encourage you to step out in faith and do that. It may look like that. Your obedience may bless someone else exactly where they need it. It may be listening to the Holy Spirit and finally, for the first time ever, thinking, you know what, I need to go speak to that coworker. I've been putting it off. I need to go speak to that coworker and finally sharing the gospel with that person. Listen, prophecy is not inspiration. Prophecy is not inspiration. It's not the final authority. Scripture is. Nor is Scripture, the revelation of God, somehow incomplete that it needs prophecy. It's fully complete. And yet, how often does God use his people to declare God's word in some form or fashion, or to encourage God's people in just the right time or in just the right way? And sometimes we do that without even knowing that we did it. That we leave and think, well, that was a dud. And the Lord may have just hit somebody over the head with what God did through you. And they come back later and they share, man, this was so powerful when you told me this. I needed to hear that right then and there. And you're thinking, I didn't even know that. God is at work in those moments. That's what he's promised to do. That's as we gather on Sunday mornings, as you see your brothers and sisters and interact with them on Sunday mornings, there's a supernatural thing that's going on. God has poured out his spirit in our midst. It's not an accident that when we come together, God is doing things in our midst. 1 Thessalonians 5 tells us that we're not to quench the spirit and not to despise prophecies, but we're to test them by the scriptures and to hold fast to what is good. There is real good that God intends to do through you, maybe even this morning, that God intends to do through you, either in this community or in this church. There is good that God has for you through the pouring out of his spirit in your life. And people can grasp and actually hold fast to that. People will actually be blessed by that. The same idea applies to this dreams and visions that are mentioned. My walk with the Lord, overwhelmingly, when I hear the Lord speak, it's through his word. That's the normal way, through prayer and time in his word. That's the normal way he speaks to me. And I would just encourage you, that's the normal way to interact and to hear from him. However, I do remember particularly a moment in my life, and it was just a critical moment of trying to make a decision. And it was really come down to, am I going to trust the Lord with my life or not? Literally was kind of that moment of, am I going to do what I want to do, or am I going to trust the Lord? And I never forget, I was wrestling with that as I fell asleep. I was in the middle of prayer. Hopefully you don't fall asleep in your prayers. But in the middle of my prayers, I was wrestling with that, and I fell asleep with that on my heart. And this messenger came. I don't know how I knew it was a messenger. I really don't. This messenger came to me and said, Just encouraged me specifically, spoke exactly to what I was wrestling with when I fell asleep. Said, you need to trust the Lord right now. You can trust him right now. He's got things, but you got to trust him. And I woke up, and it just encouraged me in that moment. Some of you may have had a similar type testimony of God just revealing himself to you in a dream. Maybe that's how you came to faith. Maybe that's how the gospel, you realized, man, I've heard the gospel before, but this may be real. Maybe God's done that in your life. I love hearing those testimonies. Brother Yoon is a church planter. He was in China in the 90s, and he planted so many. God used him wonderfully to plant many churches. He was in prison. He was arrested and put in prison for illegally preaching the gospel. And during his time in prison, he had multiple visions. And here's one of his visions in his own words. I saw my life as a boy flash in front of me. It was like a curtain being pulled back, and I clearly saw that from birth, God had called me to himself. In the vision, I exclaimed, Lord, I don't even have any chance to go out and preach the gospel. Even if you open the gates of the prison at this very moment, I am so weak that I couldn't even crawl out the door. But the Lord revealed his will to me through two scriptures that I hadn't paid special notice to before this time. For God's gifts and call are irrevocable, Romans 11:29. And I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do ever greater things than these because I am going to the Father, John 14:12. And that strengthened Brother Yoon. That strengthened his resolve that God has called me to preach the gospel. I am in prison right now. I don't even know how I'm going to do it, but God has called me to preach the gospel. Just like it did for him, Holy Spirit given visions and dreams. They're meant to strengthen our faith in God's work in our lives. They're meant to strengthen our faith that God is at work in our midst, that we have a plan. And they're meant to empower our witness. Empower our witness. Maybe you haven't had a vision, or maybe you haven't had a moment of prophecy like I'm describing this morning. Nowhere does it say you have to do these things. Notice this is a descriptive passage. This isn't a command. It's describing what God is doing. However, God can and will still do supernatural things through his people. That's the point. In these last days, the downpour has begun. It feels safer a lot of times to leave the umbrella open and just kind of try to stay dry. That feels safer a lot of times. It feels like something that I can control. And yet, what we're encouraged to do here is to close the umbrella. We have a calling to live. We have a world to tell. Between the time that Jesus disappeared into the clouds and when the trumpet sounds, we are the plan. God's Spirit and God's people declaring, boldly declaring God's word is the plan. Building his church. That's the plan. And if you're a believer here in Jesus Christ, you're not left out of that plan. God's unleashed Spirit is going to fill every corner of the globe with his glory, both in the church and in the heavens, which is the second part of Joel's promise. Look at verses 19 and 20. It says, and I will show wonders in the heavens above. This is God's part. This is not something we can do. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. Well, we don't have time to cover each of these individually. A lot of commentators believe this is primarily initially referring to the immediate fall of Jerusalem that happened shortly after this in AD 70 when Rome came in and sacked Jerusalem. And that's probably accurate. However, there's this ultimate fulfillment that this prophecy is referring to. It's an ultimate fulfillment that's coming. And we don't have time to walk through each of the individual images. But just notice in these verses, I mean, if you look in verse 19, these are solar system size signs. These signs are meant to be huge. They're meant to be seen everywhere. They can be seen everywhere in the world at one time. These are solar system size scale. And you have these apocalyptic images of blood and fire and vapor of smoke. There's this overwhelming imagery that kind of comes out of this prophecy. And there's things that are meant to remind us. They're gracious glimpses. When we see this kind of this overwhelm, anything that's overwhelming, it's meant to remind us of a coming day of global judgment for all who reject Christ. Listen, Jesus truly has been handed the judgment of the nations. He is held off to this point in his grace and his mercy. But he has been handed, and that day is coming. We aren't told when that day will be, but it's coming. We're warned, nonetheless, that it's coming. And the lack of knowing an exact date doesn't undermine our confidence it's going to happen. There will be a great and awesome day of the Lord. Just as the prophecies that Jesus was going to come were ultimately fulfilled. Nobody knew exactly when, but they were ultimately fulfilled. Just as we're reading this morning, there was a prophecy that God was going to pour out his Holy Spirit. Peter standing and saying, this is when that's happening. This is ultimately, that prophecy was ultimately fulfilled. So in the same way, this prophecy of Jesus' return, it will be fulfilled. It will be fulfilled. There is a gentle rocking from the world. And the goal of it is to lull you into a false sense of safety. To lull you into even maybe agreeing with your mind. I agree there is ultimately a final judgment. I think that way. but to functionally live, to functionally live in such a way as to deny that that day is coming. Church, we cannot be lulled to sleep. Joel's prophecy is going to come true. And while we aren't called to interpret or explain every single solar eclipse, just like a rainbow in the sky, we don't know everything that's going on, but just like a rainbow in the sky, it's meant to be a reminder. It's supposed to serve as a reminder to us that day is coming. Don't miss the forest trying to make sense of every single tree. They may be doing a lot more than what we think, but that's ultimately meant for you to see. Stay awake. That's the point of those. Stay awake. Let that remind you to stay awake. Even if they last another, even if there's another 1,000 years left in them, Peter didn't accidentally call these the last days. He didn't miss it on his calendar. He wasn't mistaken. Even if they last another 1,000 years, these are the last days. This is the final act of human history. We're living in it right now. We're born in the last days. We don't know exactly when the last day is, but we are in the last days. And the curtain will fall. That act in human history will conclude when Christ returns for his bride. There is a great and awesome day of the Lord. As the Nicene Creed puts it, he will come again with glory. He came the first time. We're celebrating Palm Sunday. He came humble and seated on a donkey, and people laid the palm branches as we're celebrating this Sunday as Palm Sunday. But he will come again the second time. He will come with glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will never end. And if you're in a particular group of folks this morning, I want to talk to you. If you're here and you belong to Jesus, but when you hear this kind of imagery or when you see these kinds of signs, these just, they almost feel like apocalyptic signs, things that happen in the heavens. If that just fear starts to creep into your heart, if that's a fearful thing for you when you see that or read this, you kind of just skip over it. Listen to the response of Jesus and see how it changes what this means for us as believers. He says, now when these things, this is what Jesus talking. When he says, when these things, and when he's specifically referencing these heavenly signs and these things that are happening, the stress from the world below, he says, when these things begin to take place, here's what you're supposed to do. Straighten up and raise your heads because your redemption is drawing near. Our deliverance is coming. And the pouring out of the Spirit, the giving of the Spirit, is our guarantee. He is the security deposit, if you will, that ensures that in that day we will stand, that God's going to persevere to you to the very end. So as we look at these passages, as a believer, let it remind us, but let us not live in fear. We're supposed to be sober-minded. We're supposed to be awake, but we're not supposed to live in fear. This is our deliverance. But let it serve as a reminder that there is an intentional end point that this is all marching to. God didn't pour out his Spirit in our midst just for us to put it on cruise control. There's a plan and there's a point and there's a day that's coming. And there are those around us who are seeing these same things and they don't have any assurances whatsoever. They may have the same fear, but they have no idea what it means, how to respond. God's unleashed Spirit is filling, even now, every corner of the globe with his glory. It's happening in the church and it's happening in the heavens. And as that happens, as God's Spirit is poured out in his church, as God reveals these things in heaven, we are promised something great. Verse 21, there will be a great response. This is one of those yes and amen verses. One of these verses you just love to read and hang on to. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. There's no if, and, or buts about it. God's unleashed Spirit in God's church will cause people to call upon the name of the Lord. And while Joel, this is a beautiful thing, while Joel may not have known exactly the name that was going to be spoken, like Peter, we know. Like Peter, we know. We as a church, we can stand and we know the name. We can proclaim the name that is above every name. That is the name of Jesus Christ. The name that literally means Savior. That's our opportunity. We're promised that everyone who calls upon, we heard the testimonies this morning, everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. It's what we have trusted in. God's unleashed Spirit, it's going to fill every corner of the globe. There's going to be people from every tongue. There's going to be people from every tribe. There's going to be people from every language, and they're going to be together. We even saw the language barrier being broken supernaturally last week. But even through efforts of people learning languages and going and speaking in different languages, there are going to be people who are going to call in the name of the Lord through the signs in the heavens and through the Holy Spirit being poured out in our midst and us boldly declaring the gospel as we go. There are going to be people from every tongue, tribe, language, and nation represented in heaven. And everyone in that number who has called upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone. God will keep his promise. He is faithful to do so. And so this morning as we close, there's three groups of people that just kind of came to my mind this week as I was working on the message. First, if you're here today and you're a believer in Jesus Christ and you've been avoiding a moment, and when I say a moment, you know exactly the moment that I'm talking about. I don't have to tell you what it is. You've been avoiding a moment. You specifically know that God has called you. This is your time to speak. This is your opportunity. It's for someone else's good. It's for the glory of God. You know that you've been called to speak. If you've been avoiding that moment this morning, feel free. Come down. We want to pray for you. I want to encourage you. Share that in your small group. Share that with brothers and sisters who are around you. Because like we said, even if it feels like this is my moment, I'm all alone, we saw here, you're not alone in that moment. You have brothers and sisters literally in your small group who would love the opportunity to come alongside you in that moment, to know that this has got me, you know, whether it be, you know what, I need to speak to my dad. My dad's an unbeliever, and I need to speak to him. I've been putting it off, but God's calling me to that. Share that with your small group. Pray together over those things. You're not standing in that moment alone. They were there to rejoice with you, even if it doesn't go the way that you've intended for it to go. Even if you get shut down altogether, you have still stood, and that is what that you have brothers and sisters who are here to celebrate with you, to love you, to encourage you in that. So be encouraged. You're not standing alone. You don't have to avoid that moment. And let them pray. Pray for these things. Pray for an opportunity. Pray for chances, and pray for boldness. Maybe in times past, like Peter, you're saying, I've failed in that moment. I've tried my own strength. Say, Lord, I can't do this. I'm just going to acknowledge I've had opportunities and I haven't done it. Lord, do it in my life. Do it and just pray for wisdom in that moment. Peter knew God gave him words to say. He gave him exactly what he was supposed to respond. You don't stop being you, but speak the word of God in those moments. So if you're there and you've been experiencing or trying to avoid that moment, I just encourage you this morning, let this message move you one step closer towards walking into that. Second, maybe for your whole Christian life or maybe just during a recent season, there's begin to be this idea, maybe it's from the culture, maybe it's from your experience, maybe from inner cynicism if you were truly honest. You've begun to believe that somehow God's spirit is limited in your life. That somehow that, you know, God's spirit in my family, he just can't do the things. I no longer think he can do the things that he says he can do. And it's not a requirement. God doesn't have to do these things. We don't demand these things, but God can do them. God can do them. This morning, if that's you, if you've struggled with that, I just want to encourage you this morning. Let this passage remind you there is a great outpouring of God's spirit. It's not an attribute of God. It's not just a gift. It is God himself, and there is nothing that is impossible with God. As Aaron pointed out several weeks ago, that's why we gather every single Sunday morning before the service. We gather in the classroom down here to call out to God together. We all pray together, asking for God to move, asking for him to do supernatural things in our midst, asking for him to fill in where we clearly lack, for him to do what only he can do and reveal his glory in our midst. And he's been faithful. Listen, he's been faithful to answer specific requests. Mike has done a fantastic job in leads. He's been faithful. We've prayed specific things, and God has answered them and met them. In the next hour, we've seen that. We know that he can do so again. There is not a limiting factor here for God. So I just want to encourage you, if that cynicism of human logic or whatever it may be, that governor has begun to be placed on your spiritual walk with the Lord, rip it out. Confess that and say, Lord, I want to show me what you have. Show me your greatness. Show us your glory, Lord. And last, if you're here this morning, and you don't know Jesus Christ. You've never met him. You heard the testimonies this morning. You thought, man, that's never happened in my life. Never had that rebirth. Maybe it became real to your heart, the Holy Spirit, he's speaking to you. And as I talk about a great and magnificent day of the Lord, maybe that becomes real. Maybe the Holy Spirit even now is revealing to you that that's a true thing, that one day you're going to have to give an answer for the life that you've lived. Listen, on that day, if you look around this room, there's not a single person in this room. There's not a single person in this room who's lived a life good enough to answer on that day. Nobody here, no matter what they look like or how they seem on the outside, nobody here has lived a life that can answer on that day. But this morning, if you hear that and you realize that you need that, this invitation, verse 21, this invitation is for you this morning. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. That includes you. That includes you. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter where you came from. It doesn't matter what you've been through. God knew all those things before he even wrote this down in Joel. That invitation is for you this morning. If you call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning, you will be saved. That's what it says here. You can try to make it sound, I mean, in your mind, you can read it and you can think, well, there must be some other caveat. There's got to be something else I got to do. I need to add something here. No, this is what it says. This is verbatim what it says. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's what you're to do. Call upon the name of the Lord. You don't bring anything to it. You call upon the name of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, We're living in an era, in an age of an unprecedented deluge of God's Spirit. Let's not be found in the house. Let's go out in the rain. It was a lot of fun as a kid in the hurricane, by the way. Kids, don't go do that. But when the storms got down, tropical storm force winds, it was a lot of fun to go out. It's time to go out in the rain. God has things for us. God has things for you. God wants to do things in our midst. He's already doing things in our midst. There's so many testimonies that you could, one by one, you could all come up here and you could just say, God did this. God's doing this. He's revealing this. He's making a difference here. He's used so-and-so to speak into my life there. Be encouraged this morning. This is all an outworking of what God had promised. This is what God had promised. And this is what began at Pentecost. And it has a point. It has a goal. There is an end date. There's a great and magnificent day of the Lord coming. What we're experiencing, what we're living in, is that unprecedented deluge. Be encouraged this morning. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just want to say thank you. We want to say thank you this morning. Your graciousness and your kindness is overwhelming to us as your people. Lord, we just freely admit we didn't do anything to deserve it, but it's your plan. It was your work, Jesus Christ, on the cross that allowed us access to the Holy Spirit, Lord. And we just thank you for the finished work of Jesus Christ on our behalf. If there's anyone here this morning, Lord, who does not know you, I just pray that today they would call on the name of the Lord. Today would be their day of salvation. Lord, I pray if there's anyone here who has been avoiding that moment, that you would just strengthen them even now, that they would sense that you are with them and that we are with them. Lord, that you would give them a boldness and a desire to be obedient, to go and seek that moment out, Lord, and to trust you in it. Lord, I pray for those who may have begun to believe that the Holy Spirit that is limited in our midst, Lord, I just pray that you would remind us again of your greatness and your glory. Lord, I just pray you would satisfy your people and use us mightily. Use us mightily to see supernatural things done in Round Rock, Texas. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'd like to take a moment, if I could, and Bart, is Jessica in children's ministry right now? She is, okay. Can we just take a moment, and I want to thank Bart specifically for serving us, especially because of how hard it is to prepare a message when you also have a full-time job that has nothing to do with preparing a message. Both Aaron and Bart, Aaron last year, thankfully not having to do that as much this year, but Bart still serves us in his spare time and just prepared such an excellent message from God's Word. So can we thank him for that, for serving us? Thank you, buddy. Excellent. And if you would do me a favor also, especially if she's serving in your child's class, if you could thank Jessica Lipscomb as well, because she has to give up Bart for the extra prep time to do that. So thank her as well, if you would.